dignitaries, supporters, Tariq Zinle, Kagyalle, and all the supporters from different parts of Ladakh, of course, Phyang village, and different parts of India and the world. It gives me pleasure to have this small event to start a big journey and to be blessed by the presence of none other than the United Nations Ambassador for Mountain Partnership worldwide, to sow a seed of mountain knowledge, research and development. And on this desert, which is as is characteristic of entire Trans-Himalayan dry desert land, we hope to slowly green this and create a university that will, an alternative university that will hopefully attract people not only from Ladakh, who have very few opportunities for higher education, not to speak of higher education that is relevant to the mountains, but any higher education, and because of which roughly 15,000 young students from Ladakh, Leh and Kargil are left to go out into the hot plains to spend 4, 5, 6 years in the name of education and not find anything that is relevant back in Ladakh, and therefore often return more as misfits than to contribute to the people of Ladakh. And therefore, apart from being a great opportunity for young people from Ladakh who can now study things relevant to their own lives right here in Ladakh, it's an issue for more than just Ladakhis. It's an issue for all the mountain regions of the world, whether it is the Himalayas or Andes or Alps, that very little is found in education to prepare young people for a life in the mountains. And when they don't find the skills that will make them happier in the mountains and are, on the other hand, made to feel like a minority in the world, an environmental minority in the mountains, a technological minority in the mountains, and before that, they're already, most of the times, people of the mountains are a linguistic minority, an ethnic minority, and that makes them often feel smaller than others, inferior to others, and therefore the need was felt that there should be one institute, hopefully more in the future, that caters to this vacuum in higher education, preparing young mountain people for the mountains so that they can take care of livelihoods in the mountains, dignified livelihoods, the culture of the mountains, the environment of the mountains, particularly fragile and even more challenged due to the climate change and other environmental vagaries that we now face. In the light of all these issues of the climate level, ranging from melting glaciers to cloudbursts and floods and disasters, we need to prepare our young people for facing these and changing the future or adapting to the future and to climate change. And therefore, all the more importance of an institute that pioneers, and then we hope we'll see many more institutes all over the Himalayas and in the mountains that has a focus towards mountains. Apart from a focus towards mountains, we would like it to be a different kind of higher education, where it's not about caging young people in their 20s who are capable of so much more into classrooms, subjected to constant lectures and notes and paper examinations and paper degrees, paper knowledge. We hope this university will also be different in how it administers or facilitates learning by experiential doing. Therefore, a university of makers and doers, where young people spend more time in the field applying the little theory that they may learn, or the much of the things that they may learn from the experts, teachers, and books, applied in the field, so that they have a knowledge of having done things. And therefore, whether it is the School of Tourism, which School of Sustainable Mountain Tourism, where we hope to run tourism programs already started in the village of Phyang with homestays and farm stays, or solar heated mud hotels of the highest end that the students would run and faculty would facilitate, so that the students have a hands-on experience when they get out and are ready for the world. Or if it is sustainable mountain agriculture, then we would have our students doing things on the ground, planting, sowing, seeing fruits come and be ready for the world. And in that, we are really happy that on this desert today, apart from laying what I might call the world's biggest foundation stone, huh? You may not have heard of a bigger stone than this, a part of the mountain itself. We hope to start, with the help of friends from Srinagar, who are revolutionizing apple orchards in Kashmir, farm to you and root to fruit, led by Khurram, who, after a lot of stints in the world around, and particularly in the US, has come back to change the lives of farmers in Kashmir, and a kind of revolution of how much the farmers can earn from their own land with very little interference by middle people. We wanted to learn from them. It was a great opportunity and a serendipity that we met them, and they readily agreed to come and extend their expertise here. And therefore, we are happy that today we'll also be starting the apple orchard program here with a small model farm, and we hope we'll all be involved and engaged in that with a sapling that we all will plant with His Holiness's blessings. And we are very happy that as part of the infrastructure, apart from orchards, which will be a landmark of this desert being green, starting of the schools and buildings, we have support from Petronet to start the first building, so that we can have a beginning of the whole university. And we are very grateful for the support from the state government, and we are at advanced discussions about passing a special bill in the Assembly of Jammu and Kashmir for a state university, state private university, that will be Hayal. And we have been discussing with the in the last weeks with the Minister for Education, the Secretary for Education, the advisor to the Chief Minister, and in the coming weeks we hope to have meetings with the Chief Minister and His Excellency the Governor. They have even discussed about supporting this alternative university with the infrastructure in Taru. This is being discussed in the first 3 years. While infrastructure comes up on this desert, we hope to collaborate with the Kashmir University and the J&K government to jointly, symbiotically make this kickstart, and also kickstart the satellite campus of the Kashmir University, which could provide much more services to the people, to take care of the concerns of Ladakhi students at a very lonely campus on the desert. We hope to join hands and make it good for both the universities, and perhaps in future do joint courses where the theoretical parts of the courses could be taken care of from the university there, and the courses that the university runs, the Hayal setup could add the experiential part, as today in this world, experiential education is one of the biggest concerns among educationists as well as common people, because our young people come out with big degrees but very little experience or readiness for the real life. So our hope is that in the coming years, with the blessing of Your Holiness, the leaders of Ladakh and supporters from Phyang, Ladakh and the world, to have a bustling student township which could be slowly greened. We are starting with bore wells to start the greenery, and hope that in the coming years the understanding about water issues that have arisen will be settled, and slowly this will be an example of optimizing water in high Himalayas. Our ancestors farmed where there was streams from glacial melt water, glaciers. But our ancestors did not have techniques of using that stream water more than or beyond the stream sides. And now with technologies like pipes, which our ancestors never had, or now artificial glaciers, which was initiated in the recent years by Aba Norfelle, and we have been experimenting with different models, and in a way in this artificial glacier world, Ladakh has already become a kind of leading place for the whole world. Places from South America to Switzerland, Alps, are looking at us. To Central Asian countries like Kyrgyzstan are looking up to Ladakh to have such solutions for them also. So we hope that Phyang stream, which has a lot of glaciers and therefore a big flow of water, can be used most optimally. Right now, as per a very rough calculation, there will be better studies conducted by institutes like Wadia Institute, who have expressed interest to study the availability of water and optimization possibilities. But even a very rough study shows us that of the roughly 30 million cubic meters of water that flows in the Phyang stream, only 5% is being used by Phyang, all the length of Phyang Valley, and culminating with Pei Village. 95% of the water is going into the Indus and into the Arabian Sea, with very little use even downstream. So, if we use modern technologies that are now available and were not available to our ancestors, we could easily, very easily, even with 5% more usage of water, we could green the whole desert from here to the Indus, which is roughly 10 kilometers in length and 3 kilometers in width. There is enough water to green all this place using, where possible, reservoirs, where possible, artificial glaciers, and very frugal use of water using drip irrigation and other techniques of water conservation. We could easily green such deserts and be an example or a model for all the villages of Ladakh, because we all Ladakhis know that every village is based or started on the stream, and each stream is overflowing and excessively during the summer, midsummer, and during the winter, while there are huge deserts lying barren next to the village. And it was this limitation that our ancestors had, that in springtime, when the stream is so small, they could only green so much. But after spring, there's so much excess of water, even floods. That gap could be filled by new technologies like artificial glaciers, reservoirs, drip irrigation, and so on. This, we hope, will be an example for Ladakh and for the world. With ice stupas, we are happy to say that somehow, even without any effort, sporadic replication of ice stupas has been happening in different parts of Ladakh. And we are very happy that there are people from Kargil who are here, a school that created an artificial glacier on their own. And inspired by such efforts, we are going to start an award for the valley, for the village that makes the biggest ice stupas in their valley, so that water could be conserved, and so that children, youngsters, learn to live with shortage of water, but then adaptation to that situation. So we are very happy, as it will be announced later, to announce a small award this year for the ice stupas that are being made. And from next year, we hope to keep a much bigger award of 10 lakh rupees for the village or the club or the region, not only in Ladakh, but around the mountains of the world. Already we hear that in Skardu, Baltistan, they are making us ice stupas. So worldwide, we hope to launch an award also, which will encourage young people to handle this issue of water. This is possible thanks to the Rolex Award that I would say Ladakh got for these new innovations. And part of that money, because we have got so many supporters in India, that the Rolex Award money, we are hoping to use a part of it to encourage similar innovations in other valleys in Ladakh. So from that amount, we hope to use a little money to encourage this series of movement, in a way, of water conservation. For this university, we started our campaign to raise funds with the Rolex Award as a seed money, and we are happy to tell you that that roughly 1 crore rupees that came as a seed money for Ladakh and Phyang, where this ice stupa was made, we started a crowdfunding campaign which was supported by people from all over India and all over the world, including students in grades like 7th, 8th grade, who did their own campaigns to make a university happen. We have been now roughly able to raise roughly 7 crore of rupees, and I feel very happy, thank you, to say that many Ladakhi common citizens contributed that crowdfunding. And apart from the Rolex Award of roughly 1 crore, I feel very happy that from the talks in corporate organizations, I was personally able to contribute another 1.5 crore. Therefore, a total of 2.5 crores, with so many other worldwide supporters and the blessings of His Holiness and the people of Phyang village and all over Ladakh. We hope to now start raising funds from corporate social responsibility. Having started with people of the world, we slowly go to the corporate social responsibility, CSR funds. And on the part of the government, we are very grateful already for the Hill Council, which is represented here by Ka Gyalwangel. The Hill Council has gone out of the way, together with the people of Phyang Valley and the Monastery of Phyang, to earmark and now actually allocate roughly 1,076 canals for this university. So with such support from within Ladakh and financial support from world over, the day will not be far when we'll have a bustling township of students of the mountain regions of the world over here in this desert, where today we only start a small step in the big journey, and we'll continue to hope for your support, all of you. And I thank you very much for joining us in this small step today. Thank you very much.